Paris in the fall, the last months of the year and the end of the millennium. The city holds many memories for me, of cafes, of music, of love, and of death. As I picked myself up, all I could hear was the ceaseless drone of traffic. Life went on around me, but the explosion was to change my life forever. The umbrella had protected me from the bomb blast, but it was of no use to me now. I contemplated crawling under the umbrella and pretending none of this had ever happened. It was an iron lamppost. Wrapped around the lamppost was a newspaper. The leading article referred to the visit of a Nobel Prize winner from some unpronounceable Eastern European state. That was the only news story. The rest was rumor, gossip, and sensationalism. Then I noticed the writing at the foot of the page. It read Salah ed-Din, 1345. The table had been overturned by the explosion. I considered straightening the table, but I figured it best not to disturb the evidence. The blast had blown out the glass, leaving a gaping hole. I examined the jagged glass remaining in the window. It was broken, all right. It was the body of the old man. It was hard to believe I'd seen him alive only minutes before. I tried not to meet his stare as I searched the dead man's pockets. No wallet, no papers, no credit cards. The guy's past was a blank page. A mysteriously undamaged bottle of spirit stood on the bar. I needed a stiff drink, but I hated the taste of brandy. The pretty young waitress was unconscious.
Oh, my head. Never again. How much vodka did I drink? Oh, no, don't tell me. What is your name, Sherry?
George Stobbart, ma'am.
Oh, American.
She asked the question quite innocently, but I could sense her reserve. It was something which seemed to afflict all Europeans. You look like you could use a little help.
I could use a little drink. I feel sick, dizzy, and bruised. I don't even remember the party.
Just relax and take it easy. You've been knocked out.
You don't say. What happened?
There's been an explosion. You should try not to move.
Are you a doctor?
No, but I used to play hospitals when I was a kid. Can you remember anything at all?
No. I need a drink. Pour me a brandy.
Is that straight or with ice?
Just give me the bottle with a teat on it.
I guess a little drop won't hurt.
Ah, that's better.
She knocked back the brandy as if it was water. I was glad I wasn't picking up the check.
What about the old man? Is he dead?
Yes, he is.
Oh, mon Dieu. I've never seen a real-life corpse before, except for Grandmaman. That was different. She was family. Has he gone stiff?
I shouldn't think so. He's only been dead a few minutes. Did you know the old man?
No, monsieur. I never saw him before.
How did the old man behave?
Well, agitated. He kept looking about him, at the door, at his watch.
As if he was waiting for someone?
Yes, I suppose so. He was worried about something, that's for sure. If you ask me, he was having an affair. He had that look about him, like a guilty husband.
Do you remember what happened when the clown entered?
I remember that horrible tune he played, all right. It was like a funeral dirge.
I'd never liked accordion music either. Did the clown speak to the old man?
No, he just laughed at him. Then he grabbed the old man's briefcase and ran out of the door.
Did you see what the old man had in his briefcase?
No, he didn't open it.
What did the old man do when the clown snatched his briefcase?
Nothing. He just sat there like he was frozen.
Did the old man try to stop the clown?
Oh, he didn't have a chance. The clown dropped his accordion and ran out of the door. That's it. That's all I can remember.
Did this newspaper belong to the old gentleman?
I don't know.
Someone has scribbled a note on it. It reads, Sala ed-Din, 1345. Does that mean anything to you?
No, monsieur, nothing.
About this newspaper.
I told you, it means nothing to me.
Stay here, mademoiselle. I'm going to look around for evidence. The sight of the dead guy's staring eyes turned my knees to jelly. I checked his pockets. Nothing. The drainpipe looked as if it would bear my weight. I took a deep breath and prepared to climb the drainpipe. I guess the clown had an escape over the rooftops. The drainpipe hung limp and useless. I decided I'd had enough of messing with that drainpipe. The window was protected by stout-looking iron bars. It was a battered old trash can. It was a stack of cardboard boxes which had once contained bottles of wine. I examined the boxes closely. They were damp and smelly and decidedly empty. It smelled like someone had dumped a truckload of fish in a locker room on a hot summer afternoon. It was a plastic crate. There was nothing of interest. It was an iron cover concealing the entrance to a drain or sewer. I tried to lift the cover with my fingers, but couldn't gain any leverage.
Right there.
Oh, don't shoot. I'm innocent. I'm an American.
Can't make up your mind, huh?
I demand to see the American consul.
Drop your weapons and get down on the ground.
Put that thing away, Sergeant Moo. I apologize, monsieur, but I cannot permit you to leave.
Am I under arrest?
No. I would simply like to ask you some questions. En avant, to the café, marche. What a mess. This bombing is an outrage, is it not?
Stop that, monsieur. Stop holding your breath at once.
Has it occurred to you that he may be dead, Mou?
Oui, monsieur. But I prefer to look on the bright side. Besides, I recall a case where the killer escaped by feigning death. However, in this case, the man is quite dead. Clearly, the killer knew of his presence and...
How many times have I warned you about premature extrapolation? All we know is that he is dead.
It seemed reasonable to assume...
A great detective assumes nothing. Take Maigret, for instance.
But he was a fictitious character, monsieur. Why, he was no more real than Poirot or Tintin.
That's different, Mou. They were comedy Belgians. Anyway, it is unlikely that even you will learn much from talking to the dead. Examine the girl and take her statement, if you can.
I doubt if she is in a fit state for questioning, monsieur. It smells to me as if she has been drinking.
As I feared. We have stumbled upon a den of iniquity, Mou.
Leave her to me, sir. I am used to handling drunken women.
I do not doubt that for one moment. Et maintenant, to business. Your name, please?
George Stobbart. I'm from California.
And what brings you to Paris, Monsieur Stobbart?
Travel. I'm touring Europe.
You chose well. The city is most beautiful at this time of year, no?
Yeah, I guess so, apart from the bomb blasts.
Were you in the vicinity of the cafe at the time of the explosion?
Yeah, I was sitting out on the sidewalk. I was lucky I wasn't killed. The inspector passed over my remark with no reaction.
Did you see the deceased enter the cafe?
Yes, I did.
Was he alone?
Yeah.
And did he say anything to you?
No. He was more interested in the waitress.
Did you see anyone else in the cafe?
Yeah, there was a guy dressed as a clown. He was carrying an accordion.
An accordion? Bon, the picture is forming in my mind, and it is not a pretty one. Is the girl all right, Mu?
She'll live if she survives the hangover. She doesn't remember seeing a clown, monsieur.
That's odd, don't you think, monsieur? Who am I to believe, I wonder? Eh bien, I have heard enough.
What do you mean?
I am satisfied that you know nothing. You may leave. I hope this little incident does not spoil the rest of your vacation.
What about my personal safety? Can't you at least give me some advice?
What can I say? Stay alert and look out for suspicious characters.
And don't cross the road until the little man shows green.
Great advice.
I honestly believe you are in no danger, monsieur. Should you remember anything of importance, please contact me. My card.
Thanks.
That is all. You may go.
There's not much to go on, monsieur.
On the surface, no. But what lurks inside the subconscious? If the door can only be opened.
Are you serious, monsieur? I thought your interest in psychic detection was purely academic.
Academic? You are about to witness a scientific breakthrough.
The girl presented a confident but sullen mask to the world, an expression more suited to the face of a delinquent youth. The sergeant was a scrawny man in his 50s who resembled a constipated chicken. Excuse me, mademoiselle? Hi, my name's George Stobbart.
Oh, an American by the sound of it.
Yeah, that's right, on holiday in Paris. Some holiday, huh?
You were here when the bomb went off?
Sure was. Sat right out front of the cafe.
Did you notice a middle-aged man, maybe 60, with an hat and overcoat?
I couldn't believe it. She hadn't even asked how I was feeling. Yeah, he went inside just before the bomb exploded. You weren't related to him, were you?
Oh no, nothing like that. I am Nicole Collard from La Lipete.
What's that, some kind of nightclub?
No, it is a newspaper.
You're a reporter?
I'm a freelance photojournalist.
Say, you can interview me about the bombing. You know, an eyewitness account. Minutes after the outrage that shook the whole of Paris. You know, real-life drama, human interest, that kind of stuff.
I'll just stick to the facts, thank you. Did you see who planted the bomb?
I know it sounds crazy, but he was dressed like a clown.
Oh, God. It's him again.
Have you met the clown before?
It's a long story.
I have plenty of time.
I don't.
Do you know a police officer called Rosso?
Rosso? Our paths have a knack of crossing. If I didn't know better, I'd say it was deliberate. Have you seen Rosso? Is he here?
He's inside. Attempting to question a witness with his psychic powers.
What? That guy is weird.
Yeah. Rosso didn't blink when I told him about the clown. It's as if he already knew.
That is typical of a cold fish like Rosso. I've seen cheeseburgers with more spunk.
You speak very good English for a French girl.
Thanks. You speak very good English for an American.
I found this newspaper outside the cafe.
That is not a newspaper, it's a gossip rag.
There's something written in it. Salah ed-Din, 1345.
It sounds like a betting tip. The name of the horse and the time of the race. What do you think?
I don't think it is. That's too obvious. I wouldn't mind betting. This is a coded message.
It's a romantic notion, but I don't think so.
Look, the inspector gave me his card.
Oh, I didn't know his first name was Augustin. It suits him, I must say.
Who's the guy you were supposed to meet?
His name was Planteur. I didn't know him, but he called me last night. He said he had a story which would interest me. He asked me to meet him at the cafe. I guess I'll never know what he wanted to tell me.
Not unless you have Rosso's gift for psychic interrogation. How did Plantar get your name?
Through the newspaper La Liberté. I'd written an article linking two unsolved murders. One in Italy, the other in Japan. The cases were remarkably similar. A wealthy victim, no apparent motive, and a costumed killer. Planta said he could supply me with more information.
Why won't you tell me about this clown?
Why do you want to get involved?
Because he almost killed me. Isn't that reason enough?
I guess so. Listen, I'll give you my phone number. You help me with my story, and I'll let you in on what I know. And let's get one thing straight right now. This is strictly business.
Okay, it's a deal.
I have to go develop these pictures. A bientôt, monsieur.
Fine, I'll see you soon. Excuse me, Sergeant.
You are the inspector. Go on, monsieur.
Did you find the victim's briefcase yet?
No, sir. The inspector gave me specific instructions to guard this door. Until he countermands these orders or backup arrives, here I stay.
I really did see the clown. He ran into the alley across the street.
Did you follow him?
I lost him. I figure he went underground.
Do you know how many kilometers of sewers there are beneath this great city?
It's not a question I've lost sleep over.
I have no doubt that Inspector Rosso will organize a proper search.
How did you and Rosso arrive at the scene of the explosion so quickly? You arrived within minutes. Was it a tip-off?
Inspector Rosso's sources are a perpetual mystery to me, monsieur. There are some who say he has made a pact with the devil.
And what do you think?
I think he is the devil.
What is Rosso doing with that girl?
He is giving her the once-over, as you Americans say.
Huh?
Once he gets his teeth into a case, nothing will shake him off.
Was he serious about all that psycho-detective stuff?
Of course. Inspector Rosso is a pioneer and a visionary. His revolutionary methods, once perfected, may change the face of law enforcement forever.
I can't see it taking off in L.A. I was one of the last people to see the victim alive, Sergeant.
Does that worry you?
Yes, it does. I feel I kinda... I owe it to him to find his killer.
That is best left to the authorities, monsieur. Did he speak to you? Tell you anything?
No. He just grinned and nodded.
Don't let it trouble you, monsieur. Go home and try to forget.
I know the identity of the dead guy. His name was Plantau.
Is that so? You knew him, did you?
No, but...
We'll know everything there is to know about him soon enough.
I'm trying to be helpful here.
The best way you can help us is to go home, monsieur.
I found this in the street, Sergeant.
That, monsieur, is a newspaper, no?
There's a note written on it. Salah ed-Din, 1345.
Ah, so the meeting with the clown was planned.
How do you make that out?
The time of the explosion was between 1:30 and 2:00, Nesta.
I guess so. But what about the name?
Aha!
That stumped you, hasn't it?
I have never been stumped, as you put it, in my life, monsieur. It is the name assumed by the clown, no?
Salah Eddin the clown? I don't think so. Did I show you this newspaper?
Yes, monsieur.
Look, Sergeant, the inspector gave me his card.
Yes, monsieur. He wants you to advise him if you have any information concerning this case.
Well, I'd be glad to talk with him, but I don't want him working his psycho weirdness on me.
Ah, no, monsieur. You are confusing the science of parapsychology with witchcraft.
Oh, yeah? What's the difference?
We don't do sacrifices.
I've got Inspector Rosso's address card.
Yes, monsieur. You showed me before.
See you later, Sergeant.
The muscular workman wore a morose expression, like a silent warning to leave him to get on with his job. Hi, can you spare a few minutes?
I thought you'd been arrested.
No, it was a misunderstanding.
When he pulled that gun, I thought that was it. Those automatics pack quite a punch, you know?
He made a mistake. He thought I was a terrorist.
You? A terrorist? Ha!
He was only doing his duty, I guess. Did you see an old guy with a briefcase?
Wait, silly old coot. Do you know what he said to me? Work fascinates me, he says. I could watch it all day. Care beat. I could have knocked his block off.
Did you recognize the old man?
No. Should I have done? Was he a celebrity?
No, but I guess he is now. His name was Plantar.
Was? He's dead then?
Yeah.
That's too bad. Now I wish I hadn't called him what I did. If only I could turn back the clock. If only I'd been more tolerant.
Regret and remorse are strange emotions. They really bring out the hammiest actors in people. Did you see a clown come by this way?
A clown? Like, in a circus?
Yeah, with makeup and a big red nose.
Oh, those guys are funny, aren't they?
Not in my experience.
I love the circus, especially the horses.
You haven't answered my question. Have you seen a clown?
You think I've got time to watch everyone who passes by? Some of us have to work for a living.
Look, I know you're busy, but surely you'd have noticed a clown.
I told you already! I didn't see a thing!
He was wearing multicolored baggy trousers and makeup.
He'd be a poor sort of clown if he didn't.
Listen, I have to find that clown. He's a killer.
Say, who are you anyhow? A cop?
No, of course not. I mean, do I look like a cop?
I guess not. How do you know this guy's a killer? Did you see him in action?
Didn't you hear the explosion? The cafe was blown up.
The clown killed the old man?
That's right. Blew him up with a bomb concealed in his squeeze box.
Merde. But why did he go to the bother of dressing up like a clown?
Who can unravel the tangled logic of a killer's mind? I guess it's some deep-seated psychological need. Or just plain showmanship. Would you like to read my newspaper?
I haven't got time to read that. Can't you see I'm busy?
You could read it on your lunch break.
10 minutes is all I get. And if my boss had his way, I wouldn't get that. He'd have me on a drip, so I didn't have to stop to eat.
Oh, take the newspaper and quit complaining.
Bah! Look at this! Damn bleeding out liberals! Cha! Save the dolphins! Catch them and eat them, I say! All that fuss over a bunch of fish! Nah, that's more like it. Look at the size of those. Like champagne bottle corks, no? Ah, what's this? Saladin running in the Prix de l'Arc de Triomphe.
It's a racehorse?
A horse? A legend. Bucephalus reborn, mon ami. Like a streak of lightning she is. Do me a favor, won't you? Keep an eye on my hull. I'm off to put some money on that nag.
It was a tent made out of plastic sheeting. It was a huge and weighty-looking engineer's telephone.
Bonjour, Couleur.
Oh, hi. It's George Stobbart, the American at the cafe.
Ah, oui.
You said to call if I could help.
Have you any news for me?
Well, I haven't had a lot of luck.
You found nothing?
No.
Look, I'm very busy right now. Call me if you have any news, okay?
Oh, yeah, I guess.
Adieu, monsieur.
Yeah, see ya.
It was a tent made out of plastic sheeting. There was nothing inside the tent except a large toolbox. It was a battered metal toolbox. I'd found just what I wanted, a tool for lifting manhole covers. It was a metal rod with a handle at one end and a short cross piece at the other. I lifted the cover to reveal what smelt like the entrance to a sewer. A shiny red plastic ball sat incongruously on the slippery green-slimed floor. As I picked up the plastic ball, I realized it was intended to be worn. It was the clown's red nose. It was a soggy, crumpled paper tissue. I scooped up the soggy tissue. It was cold and greasy, like breakfast leftovers. It was a small scrap of cloth caught on the resting spike. I took hold of the scrap of material and unsnagged it from the spike. The railing was put there for a simple reason, to stop people getting past. It worked. It was the scrap of material I'd found in the sewer.
Lie there.
Hold it right there, you sore rat. I knew you'd come back, and now I've got you.
What are you talking about?
You're trespassing. Come out of there, immediately.
That's what I'm trying to do. Give me your hand.
Ha! You won't catch me with tricks like that. Keep your distance, monsieur.
Okay.
Now, what were you looking for?
I was looking for a clown.
Huh, ridiculous. Do you really expect me to believe that?
He planted a bomb in the cafe and blew it up.
What? The cafe? Blown up? Mon Dieu, that is awful. And you say the person responsible was dressed as a clown?
That's right. He blew up the cafe, escaped into the sewer, changed his clothes, and came up here.
Ah, mon Dieu! Then, the man I chased, do you think that man and the clown are one and the same?
Well, yes, it had crossed my mind.
Ah, that still does not explain what you are doing down the sewer. For all I know, you are in league with him.
Oh no, I'm just a tourist.
Haha, most tourists are content with the Eiffel Tower, the Louvre, or the Pigalle. I didn't realize my waste pipes were such an attraction.
Tell me about the man you apprehended.
What is there to tell? He was a typical criminal type, just like you.
Does the name Plantar mean anything to you?
No, it doesn't. Who is he?
The man who was killed in the cafe. I'm gonna find the guy responsible. I'll find him. Even if it means following him down every sewer in every city in Europe.
Ah, you need some sensible boots. You won't get far in those stupid sneakers.
Do you know the waitress at the cafe?
Oh, she isn't hurt, is she?
No, she's fine.
Oh, thank heavens. A poor girl like her isn't safe with the likes of you roaming the streets.
Can't you understand? I'm not a gangster. I'm an American tourist.
That's what you say.
Was the guy you saw carrying a briefcase?
I didn't notice. Now are you going to leave? Or do I have to call the police?
Take a look at this false nose.
I've never seen it before in my life.
This is what I used to open the manhole cover.
Just as I thought. You were up to no good down those sewers, weren't you?
One slip and I would have been up to my neck. Do you recognize this material?
I am not telling you anything.
Perhaps you'd like to take a look at my card?
Mm-hmm. What is this? Inspector Augustin Rosso? What does that say? Hominoid Division?
A homicide. I think the ink's smudged.
Mm-hmm. Then you are not a tourist.
Okay, I'm not. I lied to you. And I'm sorry.
Don't apologize, monsieur. You know, I had a feeling there was something different about you. It is your posture, your poise. Oh, yes. There is no mistaking the bearing of a disciplined man. And I should know. I was in the army, you know. When I was your age, I was fighting for my life in the African desert. How can I help you, Inspector?
Let's start over from the beginning and tell it just like it was. Tell me about the man you apprehended.
He was a mean one, monsieur. He grabbed me in an arm lock. His face suddenly next to mine. His grip was like iron, but he did not know what he was up against. Oh no! He made a big mistake when he took on one of the desert hyenas.
Yes, I get the picture. Does the name Plantar mean anything to you?
No, it doesn't.
Do you know the waitress at the cafe?
So you don't want to hear about my experiences in the desert? I fought to make this country what it is today.
I'm sure you did, but I'm a little short of time. Do you know the waitress at the cafe?
You can't suspect her, surely.
Just answer the question, please.
Yes, I know her quite well, you could say. She came to work at the cafe 6, 7 months ago. I look forward all week to the relief she gives me when she visits.
Really? So you'd miss her if she wasn't there?
Oh, mais oui! Who else would I find to cut my toenails?
Was the guy you saw carrying a briefcase?
Why, yes, he was. Clutched in his arms like a baby.
That belonged to his victim.
Oh, what do you think was in it? Drugs? Stolen jewels?
I don't know. But the killer thought it was worth a man's life.
Nothing is worth that, monsieur.
Take a look at this false nose.
Aha! Uh-huh. That looks like a clown's nose to me.
Precisely. He must have dropped it in his panic.
Unless he wanted you to find it.
Why would he want to do that?
To put you off the scent.
Take a look at this false nose.
You showed me before, monsieur.
Did I show you my tool?
Oui, monsieur. Just like mine. Except that it is much smaller.
Does this piece of material mean anything to you?
That is the same cloth as the jacket I found. I'd recognize that pattern anywhere.
This is the material from the jacket you found, right?
Yes, monsieur. Without a doubt.
Now, about the jacket you found. Do you have it here?
No, monsieur. One of the sleeves was badly torn, so I sent it for repair. A pity, because otherwise it was a fine piece of quality tailoring. It had the tailor's name inside on the label.
Where did you send the jacket?
I gave it to an itinerant Romani seamstress.
Just my luck. Was there anything in the jacket pockets?
Not a sou. You know what I think?
Do tell me.
He changed out of the clown suit and cunningly disguised himself as an ordinary person.
Looks like I'm up against a mastermind. What was the name on the label?
It was a foreign name. Todrick, I think.
Did you get the address?
There wasn't one, monsieur. Only a telephone number.
Well, I don't expect you to remember a phone number you've only seen once.
74-98-08-59.
You're kidding. That's his phone number?
Yes, that's it. A little secret number that I learned in the desert. I was taught the technique by a Tuareg shaman.
That's incredible.
It comes in handy at the supermarket checkout. Do I get a reward?
Honesty, monsieur, is its own reward.
Then I'm glad I do not rely on honesty to pay the bills.
What does this tissue mean to you?
Nothing, monsieur. It's disgusting. What on earth possessed you to show it to me? Someone has emptied their nostrils into it.
I have to be going. Thanks to your help, the citizens of Paris can sleep a little easier tonight.
Vraiment? I was only doing my duty, monsieur. Good luck, Inspector. I hope you catch that killer soon. I'll let you out. I hope you find your man, Inspector.
So do I.
Hello? Who is this? Hi. My name's George Stobbart. You don't know me.
Correct, Mr. Stobbart. I don't. What can I do for you?
Well, I'm trying to trace one of your customers. Could I maybe come over and talk to you?
No. No. That's not possible.
Oh, okay. Forget it. Listen, all I want is a name.
What are you talking about? Who are you working for?
I guess you might say I'm acting in the interests of truth and justice.
Ah, thank God. I thought you were the police.
There are innocent lives at stake, Mr. Todrick. Lives that you could save.
You're collecting for charity, yes?
No, I'm not. All I want from you is information.
Go on. I'm listening.
Do you know a guy called Plantar?
No, I never heard of him.
What do you know about the clown who bombed the Café de la Chandelle Verte?
I don't have no idea what you're talking about.
You're cool, Todrick. But I think you know more than you're saying.
I don't know who you be, but sure I am you don't know what you're talking about.
I don't know if you're saying that to make me think you don't know what I mean, but... Oh, this is ridiculous. Quit playing games with me, Todrick.
I tell you, I know nothing about no clown.
Shall I tell you what happened to Plantar? How he was killed in cold blood?
I told you, I never heard of Plantar.
I expect Plantar's a family man, don't you? In their little apartment, Madame Plantar is cooking the supper, listening for the familiar sound of her husband's key in the door. Junior is waiting for his daddy to come home from work. He can't wait to show him the merit marks he earned in school today. Only tonight, Monsieur Plantar won't be coming home.
You forgot the puppy.
Huh?
The faithful puppy dog, waiting for the sound of his master's voice.
Well, maybe they don't have a dog. What do you think?
I don't know, Plantar. I never heard of Plantar. None of this has anything to do with me.
Did you know that one of your customers was a part-time clown?
If a guy feels happy with a funny nose and custard down his pants, what's the problem?
Thanks for nothing, Todrick.
Bonjour, couleur.
It's me again, George Stobbart.
Hi, George. Any news?
You bet. I met a witness who spoke to the clown. And I know where the killer gets his suits.
No kidding. Hey, I'm impressed.
You are? Well, it wasn't easy.
Look, why don't you come here to my apartment?
Fine. Where do you live?
361 Rue Jarry.
Okay, I'll come right over. The shop window featured a display of gowns and women's stuff. It wasn't the style of the clothes in the shop that caught my eye, but the prices. The same amount of money would feed a starving family for the rest of their lives. I guess people who buy that kind of stuff don't have a problem with their consciences. The shop window featured a display of gowns and women's stuff. The window was full of overpriced clothes for overprivileged women. The woman was doing something with a pair of needles that couldn't be described as knitting. She was a cheery old soul, the kind you'd walk across the street to avoid. They were lilies or tulips, some kind of flowers anyhow. Pretty, I guess, if you like that sort of thing. Me? I couldn't see the point of buying something that was already half dead. Oh, hi!
Bonjour, monsieur. Would you like me to foretell your future?
No thanks.
I'm very good, and it only takes a minute.
Thanks all the same, but I'm not superstitious. Besides, if it only takes a minute, that's not much of a future to look forward to. Are the flowers for sale?
Oui, monsieur.
Okay. I'll take a bunch of those white ones.
I wouldn't do that if I was you.
No?
They are lilies, monsieur. Some people associate them with death.
Yikes. Thanks for telling me. What other flowers do you have?
Dahlias.
What do they signify?
Insecurity.
I don't want to give her the wrong idea about me. What about the tall yellow ones?
Those are iris, the flame of passion.
And the little yellow ones?
Sensuality.
Well, they're no use to me. I want to make an impression, not jump down her throat. Do you know a young woman called Nicole Collard?
Yes, I do. She lives upstairs from me, in the apartment block across the street. The door isn't locked, but you'll need to give it a gentle nudge. It sticks, you see, because of the damp. The landlord said he'd fixed it before winter sets in. He's been saying that for 3 years.
How long has Mademoiselle Collard lived here?
A few months. She's in for a shock when the cold weather comes. Drafty windows, insufficient heating, it's a struggle to keep warm. The only reason I stay is because the rent is cheap. Your young lady, she deserves better.
I thought Mademoiselle Collard was a successful photographer.
Not as successful as she makes out for all her fine clothes. Oh, I've heard her crying herself to sleep at night.
That's awful.
Now don't you let on that I've told you. She's proud, that one. Too proud, if you ask me.
I've changed my mind. Will you tell my fortune?
You're going on a long journey.
My, oh my. What a surprise. Can you tell me anything I don't already know?
10 francs, please, my dear.
10 francs? That's a ripoff.
Please yourself.
How does this fortune-telling routine work?
If I knew that, I wouldn't be selling flowers for a living.
Haven't you ever wondered why you were blessed with the gift?
Well, it's a bit like satellite television, I suppose. Some of us are born with a built-in receiver dish. I just happen to be one of the lucky ones.
Can you really foretell the future?
Only time will tell, monsieur. The strange thing is, I can't seem to see myself in the future. Other people, I have no problem. But when I try to see what might happen to me, nothing.
That must be scary.
Maybe. I figure it's a kind of natural safety mechanism. Either that, or I don't have a future.
Do you recognize this nose?
No, monsieur.
What do you make of this tool?
Is it something a dentist would use?
No, it's for raising manhole covers.
Formidable.
What can you tell me about this material?
It's a very expensive piece of cloth, monsieur.
What can you tell me about this tissue?
Nothing.
See you later.
That's right, monsieur. You will.
I inhaled deeply, expecting to experience the scent of the flowers. What I got was traffic fumes. It was a food store selling fruit and vegetables. I glanced without much interest at the fruit. It was dusty, shriveled, and tired-looking. The vacant shop was sealed with a steel blind. There was no way of lifting the securely locked blind. The door was shabby and in need of a coat of paint. I couldn't imagine the Colard woman living here. Remembering the flower seller's advice, I pushed the door gently just above the lock.
Bonjour. I'm glad you could make it, monsieur.
Please, call me George.
Fine. I'm Nicole. Take a seat, George. Eh bien? And what have you been up to?
I've been exploring the sewers beneath the cafe.
I thought I could smell something bad.
The clown used the sewer to escape and to change out of his costume. I guess he was in a hurry. He left his jacket behind.
And?
I got his tailor's phone number.
He had better luck than I did.
Luck, she said. Luck! Hard work, I'd call it. What happened?
I took my photographs to the editor, but he wasn't interested.
Can you believe it? He told me to drop the story.
But you're not about to do that.
Oh, no. I am going to find out what's behind these killings. You know what I think? It's a conspiracy. The police in three different countries have kept very quiet about the murders. The press don't connect them at all. They blame them on political, religious, or militant minority extremists.
That covers just about everyone. Tell me more about the clown's previous victims.
The first was Arno Belota, the millionaire pharmaceutical baron. He made his money from amphetamines in the post-war slimming and diet boom.
Imagine it! Millions of housewives literally spitting their butts off.
Was he killed for his money?
No. He had no living relatives. And his fortune went to the orphanage where he grew up. The only witness in the case was his Filipino au pair.
She swears he was led to his death by a snowman.
What about the clown's second victim?
Yamada, the controversial Japanese green politician. He inherited his fortune from his father's electrochemical consortium. He was committed to dismantling Japan's automobile industry.
I can't see him gaining much support with a loony policy like that.
Yamada was a man of vision. He was years ahead of his time.
If you say so. How did he die?
At the end, or should I say, flippers, of a giant emperor penguin.
A snowman, a penguin, and now a clown. You know, I hate to admit it, but this is scary. And I'll tell you what, I won't be accepting any invitations to costume parties.
I don't blame you for being scared. I am too. But this story could be my only chance of a big break.
Or a premature death. I found this false nose in the sewer.
Hey, what's this inside it?
The contents of someone's nose?
Don't be cross, George. It says La Risée du Monde. Masks and costumes. It's a costume shop near the Gare Saint-Lazare.
I'll check it out. Maybe the owner remembers who hired the clown costume.
Why don't you put it on, Georges?
No way am I wearing this. I'd look really stupid. Besides, you might have had a cold. This is the tool I used to get into the sewers.
Fascinating, Georges.
You're not interested, are you?
Oh, of course I am. I think it was very brave of you to go down those sewers.
Yeah? Well, it was kind of scary, but... Well, I had a job to do. I found a piece of material near the cafe. When I showed it to the concierge, he recognized it right away.
It's very distinctive, all right. Just wait until you see this. I developed the film I shot at the cafe. Here, George, it's an enlargement I made. Look what that guy's wearing!
Checkered pants. The same material as I found in the sewer.
That's right. This guy shouldn't be difficult to find.
Oh, no?
Take a close look at his left cheek.
A scar. In the shape of a horseshoe.
Oh, a crescent moon.
How come you enlarged this photograph of me?
Because I noticed the guy behind you, of course.
Do you want this photograph back?
No, you keep it. I can always make another print.
Tell me more about yourself.
Oh, there is not much to tell.
Well, how did you get into photography?
I guess I owe that to my father. He bought my first camera. I was 8 and my parents had just split up.
Did you live with your father?
Yes, my mother went off with her new boyfriend. I don't mind. Papa was all I needed. 4 years later, he died in a plane crash.
Ah, I'm sorry.
Well, it's all right. I don't mind talking about him. He was more like an older brother, really. Always joking and laughing. Papa always wanted I should study art. That's why I went to college.
Did you learn about photography at college?
Oh, God, no. I couldn't afford the materials. We were billed for everything we used. Paint, canvas, paper. Most of my year turned to minimalism. It was cheaper. I used to go poaching in the park for squirrel hair. The only time I wasn't hungry was the term I did printing. I used to eat the potatoes.
You're making fun of me, aren't you?
Oh, no.
Do you have a boyfriend?
That's none of your business.
I found this tissue down the sewer.
Oh, poor, that's disgusting, George.
I think the stuff on it is grease paint, like actors use. Or clowns.
It's still disgusting. Get rid of it.
May I use your telephone?
Sure, go ahead.
Thanks.
Hello? Who is this?
Mr. Todrick?
Oh, it's you again. What now?
Did you make a suit for a man with a scar on his face? A scar in the shape of a crescent moon?
Maybe. Maybe not.
Tell me where I can find him and I'll leave you alone.
And if I don't?
I won't leave you alone.
I can't tell you anything unless you give me his name.
Do you know where I can find the guy with the scar?
I told you. Without a name, I can't help you.
Thanks for nothing, Todrick. I'm going back out to search for that clown.
Where?
Well, I guess I could visit the costume shop.
Good idea.
The dummy wore a traditional Puro costume. At least, I guess it was a dummy. I gave the dummy Puro a tentative prod, but it didn't move. She reminded me of a girl I dated back in high school. Come to think of it, the dummy had more personality. As I was about to touch the dummy, I realized it had the same color eyes as Nico. The strange thing was, I hadn't realized I'd noticed the color of Nico's eyes. It was a disgustingly realistic plastic novelty, like one I'd left on the teacher's desk at school. Boy, that caused so much of a stink you'd have thought it was a real one. As my fingers closed on the plastic novelty, I realized my mistake. It was a novelty, all right, but it wasn't plastic. It was an antique phonograph, the kind you have to wind by hand. The guy's spoon-shaped face was mournful and humorless. He looked like a vegetarian in a slaughterhouse. Excuse me.
Bonjour, monsieur. Please, come in. Welcome. Leave the mundane world behind, for in these four walls, fantasy is king.
I don't want a costume.
Didn't you ever dress up when you were a child?
Not that I remember.
Incredible! You'll be telling me next that you never shared your elder sister's lingerie.
I don't have a sister, and I think I'd look pretty silly in a brassiere. I just need some information.
Of course. How can I help you?
Have you heard of a man named Plantile?
I do not recall anyone of that name.
I'm looking for a man who hired a clown costume from you.
Oui, monsieur. I do not see how I can help.
Don't you keep a record of costumes that you've rented out?
Of course, monsieur, but...
Well, then, I'd like to check your records. Give me the names of everyone who's rented a clown suit.
Impossible. There are too many.
The clown I'm looking for is a cold-blooded killer. Give me his name, and I'll see he's brought to justice.
I'd help you if I could, but you can't expect me to remember all my customers. You see, the clown costume is our most popular line, monsieur. On average, we hire out more than 30 clown suits a week. You'll have to give me more to go by. A description, perhaps?
How come clowns are so popular?
I think it has something to do with their unpredictable nature.
Personally, I think clowns should be banned, along with mimes.
Oh, come now. Who doesn't love clowns?
Me, for one. Do you want this red nose back?
Not after it's been worn, thank you.
Do you recognize this man?
Ah, oui. He was here this morning.
Are you sure this is the man who bought grease paint?
Oui, monsieur.
Are you sure this is the man who bought grease paint?
Oui, monsieur.
What does this tool mean to you?
Nothing, monsieur.
Does this dirty tissue mean anything to you?
Let me smell that. Bestheimer's number 7 white pancake.
Theatrical grease paint, right?
Oui, monsieur. La crème de la crème of Cespian accoutrement.
Have you sold any of it recently?
Yes, 2 cans.
Are you sure this is the man who bought grease paint?
Oui, monsieur. He chose 2 costumes. Bozo the clown and Seamus the pixie.
A pixie?
Very smart. Green silk with a taffeta lining. He gave me his name as Monsieur Khan.
Are you sure this is the same man who hired the clown suit?
Certainement, Monsieur Khan.
Thanks for your help, buddy.
My pleasure, monsieur. Allow me to shake you by the hand.
Huh? Well, okay. What are you trying to do, kill me?
You did not find it amusing?
I never saw the funny side of electroshock therapy.
Eh bien, it is yours to keep. A gift?
Do I need a license?
No, but I give you a word of warning, monsieur.
What?
Remember to switch it off before you visit the toilet.
Excuse me?
Oui, monsieur?
Do you want this buzzer back?
No. You keep it.
Thank you.
Salut, George. What news?
I've been to the costume shop.
Yeah, I like it. What are you supposed to be?
I didn't hire a costume. These are my clothes and you know it.
Did you ask about the clown?
Yeah. He used the name Khan. He hired two costumes, the clown and a pixie.
Then we're one jump ahead of him.
How do you make that out?
He probably plans to use the pixie suit next time he kills.
Oh, God, don't let it be me. I don't deserve to die at the hands of a pixie.
Don't be silly, George. That won't happen.
Oh, no?
No, because every time you see a pixie, you're going to run like hell.
What are you doing to help trace the killer clown?
Research, George.
Yeah? You have a copy of the clown's yearbook?
I have a telephone and lots of contacts.
Oh, well, did you find anything useful?
Not yet. I'm employing my first and most useful weapon.
What's that?
Patience.
Oh, I've heard of that. Isn't it a substitute for decisive thinking? Have you found out any more about the murders?
Well, it may be nothing, but both the clown's victims visited Paris earlier this year.
When?
The second week of July. They were both here at the same time.
Did they meet?
I don't know, but I can't imagine it was coincidence.
Do you want this photograph back?
No, you keep it. I can always make another print.
The guy at the novelty shop gave me this.
What is it?
A hand buzzer. You put it in your hand and give people electric shocks.
Why?
It's a gag, a practical joke.
If you ever use it on me, I'll break your arm.
Okay. I get the picture. Hey, Nico, shake hands with me.
No chance, Buster.
May I use your telephone?
Sure, go ahead.
Thanks.
Hello? Who is this?
It's George Stobbart again.
What now?
I found out the name of the guy I'm looking for.
Is that so?
Yeah. It's Khan. You know who I'm talking about, don't you?
Yes, I delivered the suit to his hotel. The Hotel Ubu. I don't remember the room number. It was upstairs. The second room on the right-hand side of the corridor.
Thanks, Todrick. That's all I wanted to know. Now I've got you, Mr. Clown. Now we're getting somewhere. Do you know the Hotel Ubu?
The Ubu? Yes, I do.
That's where the clown stayed.
Good work, George.
See you later.
Where are you going now?
I could go hang out at the Hotel Ubu.
Watch out for Khan, George.
Don't worry, I will. Would you like to shake my hand?
No, I wouldn't. I can see the future, remember?
Do you recognize the man in this photograph?
What a hunk.
He's a killer.
I can see that. His eyes say it all.
See you later.
That's right, monsieur. You will.
The guy looked just like a weasel. Excuse me.
Yes?
Have you heard of a guy called Plantar?
No. That name means nothing to me.
I'm looking for a clown.
Are you trying to be funny?
No, I really am looking for a clown.
There are no clowns here except you.
Do you know a man by the name of Khan?
No, I don't.
It's very important I get to see him, and...
I told you, I don't know it.
Have you ever seen this clown's nose before?
No.
Do you recognize the guy in this photograph?
No, I never saw him.
What does this tool suggest to you?
Hard labor.
Will you shake my hand?
Are you joking? Who knows where it has been?
What does this tissue mean to you?
Are you serious?
Oh, yes. Take a good look at the substance it's smeared with.
You are sick. Very sick.
Forget it. The man looked like an amiable Bigfoot. Excuse me.
Yeah?
Do you happen to know a guy named Khan?
That ain't nobody I know.
I'm sorry to be a burden on your brain. You ever meet a guy called Plantow?
No, I ain't.
You missed your chance. If you're quick, you'll catch him at the coroner's. Have you seen a guy dressed as a clown?
No, I ain't. Don't tell me I missed him. Oh, that's too bad. I love the clowns, don't you?
I've seen daytime television that was funnier.
I love it when the little guys get hurt.
That figures.
Custard pies, hose pipe down the pants, then smack! A plank in the kisser.
Have you ever seen this clown's nose before?
Nope.
Do you recognize the guy in this photograph?
Is this a trick question?
No, I simply asked if you recognized him.
Okay then. Nope, I don't.
What do these... Oh, never mind. Shake my hand.
Nah.
Oh, rats. Do you recognize this tissue? Think carefully now.
Ooh.
I'm gonna have to hurry ya.
Ooh.
Time's up, so I'll tell ya. It's a used tissue with a liberal dump of Bestheimer's number 12.
If you say so.
See you later.
Not if you see me first.
The sign listed the price of rooms, and boy, were they expensive. The killer must have been earning a fat wad to pay for accommodation like this. The lobby was quiet, almost deserted. Thank you. The woman was obviously English. She had all the qualities of Boadicea, Elizabeth I, and Margaret Thatcher rolled into one. It wasn't a pretty sight. It was a magnificent old Steinway piano. The figure of a sexless youth was frozen in mid-skip with a silly grin on its stone lips. I figured the lady at the keys wouldn't appreciate a duet with a musical illiterate like me. I recognized the guy. It was the Nobel Prize winner from the country whose name I couldn't pronounce. Excuse me, didn't I see your picture in the news? You're that Nobel Prize winner from some unpronounceable Eastern European state.
Yes, that is me, in person.
I don't want to worry you, but have you had any threats on your life? You know, mysterious phone calls, letters made up of headlines cut from the newspaper.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Do you know a guy called Plantau?
I don't know anybody in Paris.
Oh, well, this guy's dead anyhow.
Why do you ask me about dead men? I have seen enough of death to last me a lifetime.
I'm sure you have. Have you seen a clown?
I beg your pardon?
The clown, a guy in funny pants. Have you seen him?
My pants are from England. Marx and Spencer. They are a pleasure and a comfort to wear with much support.
I'm real glad to hear that. You know, it's good to know you Nobel Prize winners are human too.
In my country, the people make do with string and egg cartoons.
For pants?
For everything. Oppression is the mother of ingenuity.
What does this clown's nose suggest to you?
In my country, we have no use for clowns.
I'm glad to hear it.
They were dealt with most severely in the last cultural cleansing.
What about the mimes? Did you get them too?
All gone. Our streets are mime-free.
Sounds like heaven. Do you recognize this man? He calls himself Khan.
Yes, I know this man. Why do you carry his photograph?
I'm a private detective. What's your interest in Khan?
He is an enemy of my people.
You know he's a killer?
Of course, amongst other things.
Would you help me investigate Khan?
That is not possible. My instructions are to observe. I cannot jeopardize my position as an honored guest of this country's government.
Have you any idea what this tool might be used for?
I cannot guess.
Would it mean anything if I told you it was for lifting drain covers?
Such technology fills me with wonder.
May I shake you by the hand?
I do not shake the hands of imperialist dogs.
Now that's a real bad attitude problem you've got there. Does this goo-smeared tissue mean anything to you?
No, it doesn't.
Thanks for your help.
Goodbye.
Hi there, ma'am.
Well, hello. What can I do for you?
I'm looking for a man.
You disappoint me, my dear. For one foolish moment, I thought. But never mind. Aren't you going to tell me your name?
George. George Stobbart, ma'am.
How sweet! I once had a stable boy called George. I am Lady Pierrmont. The common reaction is to kneel and stutter, but it's not obligatory.
A real lady? I mean, you're an honest-to-God aristocrat?
Oh, I don't know about that.
Few of my ancestors are honest, not even to God. I can trace my family back to the Normans, but don't let that intimidate you, George. Beneath that impressive pedigree, I'm just flesh and blood. The blood may be blue, but the flesh is the plump beef of old England, so to speak. You appear distracted, George. Is there any way I can help you?
I'm looking for a murderer.
Good heavens! You're a private detective.
That's correct, ma'am.
What's the term you Americans use?
It's on the tip of my tongue.
I believe what you're thinking of is Dick.
Precisely.
Have you come across a man who calls himself Khan?
I am familiar with only one person named Khan.
Genghis Khan, the legendary Mongol barbarian chieftain?
No, darling. Kevin.
Kevin Khan? I never heard of him.
I'd be most surprised if you had, darling. He's a pharmacist in Hemel Hempstead. Organizes fundraising for the Rotarians. Lovely man.
Does he have a scar on his cheek?
I really wouldn't know, sweetie.
Did you know there's a gangster out front?
What makes you think he's a gangster?
The Italian suit and the bulge in his pocket?
I know plenty of men with Italian suits and bulges in their pockets. That doesn't necessarily make them gangsters.
Are you here in Paris on vacation?
No, darling, I'm on holiday.
I needed to get away after Algy's funeral.
I didn't realize you were mourning the loss of a loved one.
I'm not. He was my husband.
I'm sorry to hear about your husband's death.
You wouldn't be if you knew him, my dear. It gave me the opportunity to take a well-deserved holiday. Daphne suggested a change of scenery. Paris, she said. A wild romance is just what you need to take your mind off the inquest. Well, the closest I came to romance was being wooed by a drunken Breton chef. I must say I was disappointed with his coq au vin. Not at all what I was expecting. I was thinking of cutting my holiday short, packing my bags and heading back to Hemel Hempstead. That was until last night.
What happened to you last night?
I was stricken, Mr. Stobbart. Cupid's arrow has cleft my bosom.
They couldn't really miss.
It was just as I'd always imagined it should be. The intimacy of candlelight. Romantic music tinkling across the room. And then, a stranger's glance. Those brooding eyes, that suave manner. Those tight trousers.
He was the man I'd been waiting for all my life.
I'm glad he finally turned up after all these years.
Ah, but it wasn't to be. He was merely toying with my affections. And if I ever catch up with him, he's dead.
Who was the guy who led you on?
His name is Merlin.
Do you know what this is?
And a guess, I'd say it was a clown's nose.
That's right. It was worn as a disguise by a vicious killer.
Good heavens, are you trying to alarm me?
It's true. He uses the name Khan. Do you recognize the man in this photograph?
My God, it's him! That's Merlin!
She represented everything I loved about the English. The lady was totally deranged. Merlin? You mean King Arthur's wizard?
Good heavens, no! Monsieur Merlin is a fellow guest. He's the man I've been telling you about. That's the man who spurned me.
Did I show you this photograph?
Yes, darling.
The man you know as Merlin is a fake.
What do you mean, sweetie?
He's a murderer. He also uses the name Khan.
I am shocked, Mr. Stobbart. Shaken. I took him to be a gentleman. A man of honor.
Do you know, I'd rather like to assist you in stitching him up.
When did you last see Merlin?
It was no more than an hour ago. He came downstairs and spoke to that clerk chappy. Something passed hands. I couldn't see what exactly.
A briefcase?
No, smaller than that. A bundle of papers, perhaps. The clerk put it in the hotel safe and Merlin went out.
Are you sure you saw Merlin putting documents in the safe?
Yes, darling. Positive.
I wonder what they were.
Obviously something of great importance.
Yeah. I'd sure like to get my hands on whatever it is. I'll bet they had something to do with Plantar's briefcase. Has Merlin returned to the hotel?
No, he hasn't. Are you going to search his room?
If I could get in there, I would. Can you think of any use for this tool, ma'am?
Oh, I can think of someone I'd like to use it on.
Would you like to shake my hand, ma'am?
Now, George, there's no need to be so formal. We met as tourists, and I want to keep it that way, despite the enormous social gulf between us.
I just couldn't bring myself to use the buzzer on this dear lady. Does this tissue mean anything to you?
Good God, no!
I just thought the smell might be familiar.
Please, darling, put it away. I'm no shrinking violet, but that object makes me feel quite queasy.
I have to go, ma'am.
Wore a disdainful expression like he'd been born with it. I want some information.
Who are you? The police?
I'm conducting a private investigation.
Ah, I know only too well what you mean. That is one of the drawbacks of the catering business. When people book into an hotel, they leave their morals at home, no?
I'd like to retrieve something from your safe.
Ah, oui, monsieur. May I see some form of identification?
Like what?
A driving license, perhaps?
I don't drive.
Your passport?
I don't have it with me. I could show you my operation scar.
I'm sorry, monsieur. I must have some form of unique ID.
You won't find a more unique ID than my scar.
I'm sorry. I must insist on a more traditional identification.
Rats!
Do you know a man named Plantar?
No, monsieur.
I'm looking for a man who dresses like a clown.
This is a highly respectable hotel, monsieur. There are no clowns here.
If you say so.
Do you recognize this red nose?
No, monsieur.
Do you recognize the man in this photograph?
Yes, monsieur. That man is one of our guests.
What name?
I cannot tell you that.
What do you make of this tool?
Stunning, monsieur. I bet you handle it like a professional.
Hey, shake my hand.
I'd rather not, monsieur. I'm still sore from the shock administered by one of the guests. He was secretly concealing an electrical device in the palm of his hand. Practical jokes are so puerile, don't you think?
Oh, yeah, sure. What do you make of this tissue?
Do you wish me to dispose of it for you, monsieur?
Hey, no! It could be useful. I'm holding on to this.
As you wish, monsieur. Perhaps you would like a little plastic baggie to keep it in?
Nah, it's fine the way it is. Thanks for your help, buddy. It was the register of guests staying at the hotel.
What now, monsieur?
Thanks for your help, buddy. There was no one registered under the name of Khan, but the name in the book for room 22 was Merlin. In the ornate booth was the most elegant public telephone I'd ever seen. Hi, it's George. I have the address of the killer's hotel.
If you're going to pay him a visit, take care. Remember, that guy's a professional.
Thanks. I'll be fine. The sign on the door read 21. The door was locked. The sign on the door read 22. If the tailor's description was correct, this was the killer's room. The door was locked. Room number 23. The door was locked. Hanging from a brass hook was a key and a plastic tag.
Excusez-moi, monsieur.
What?
You were trying to steal that key, no?
No way. The clerk wore a...
What now, monsieur?
About the key hanging on the hook over there.
Oui, monsieur.
Which room is it for?
Number 21.
Is that room taken?
No. The guests checked out this morning.
I'd like to check into room 21.
That is not possible.
How come? You said it was vacant.
It is reserved for another guest.
Rats.
No, monsieur. Dutch.
Thanks for your help, buddy. Hi, ma'am.
Hello, George. What can I do for you now?
Would you distract the clerk while I borrow a key?
Are you asking me to aid you in a criminal act, darling?
Oh, no. It's the key to an empty room.
And why, may I ask, do you wish to gain access to an empty room? Do you plan to squat?
No, ma'am.
Scouts honor?
I was never in the Boy Scouts, ma'am.
Oh, you should have been. What were your parents thinking of? It's a fine way for a boy to get licked into shape. Now tell me, why do you want to get into that room?
It's next to the room the killer is using.
Ah, so you plan to eavesdrop on Merlin?
I was hoping there might be a connecting door.
I shouldn't think my feminine charms would be much use in this case, but a good dose of English arrogance might do the trick. I say! You there! Flunky!
Oui, madame.
Listen carefully. You do understand English, don't you?
But of course, madame.
Good. I wish to deposit some jewelry for safekeeping.
I understand.
Are you quite certain?
Oh, bien sûr, madame.
Over to you, my dear.
Hi, ma'am.
Hello, George. What can I do for you now?
I got the key. Thanks for your help, ma'am. I have to go, ma'am. It was a key ring bearing one large brass key and a tag which read, Hotel Ubu. Maybe it wasn't the right room, but this was the right key. It was a massive mahogany wardrobe. There was nothing in the wardrobe apart from a vague, lingering smell of camphor. A cabinet stood beside the bed. The cabinet was empty, but it smelt of onions. No kidding, it really did. The window looked out over a narrow alley surrounded by high walls. The cobbles of the alleyway looked very distant and very hard. If I wanted my shin sticking out of my shoulders, I could have jumped. Mama Stobart didn't raise no suicidal fools, though. The cabinet had no drawers, just a single door. The assassin had been too smart to leave incriminating evidence beside his bed. The bed was several times larger than the narrow cot I'd been given at the place I was staying. The bed was freshly made, and the crisp white sheets told me nothing about the killer's habits. The closet was a solid, impressive piece of antique furniture.
The pants were newly laundered and pressed with immaculate creases. There was nothing in the pockets of the pants. The interior of the closet was large enough for me to climb right in. The door led back into the hall, idiot. I had the kind of feeling in my stomach that would usually send me running to the bathroom. It was the battered leather briefcase I'd seen Plantar carrying just before he died. I searched the interior of the briefcase, but as I'd half expected, it was empty. The pants matched the jacket which the killer had lost in Paris. I couldn't believe my luck when I found two items in the pockets of the pants. The first was an ordinary matchbook. No matches, no clues. The second was a pass card which read, Thomas Merlin, Gruber Electronics Corporation. The matchbook bore a pattern of swirling color and the words, Club Alamut.
What now, monsieur?
Do you recognize this key?
That is the property of the Hotel Ubu.
Correct.
May I ask how it found its way from the little hook to your pocket?
Would you believe it was put there by a poltergeist?
No, monsieur. The hotel is regularly serviced by an exorcist. If we had a ghost, Father Fécond would have flushed it out.
I suppose you want the key back.
Not especialement. The room is vacant. Since you are so determined to conduct your little investigation, I won't stop you.
Does this pass mean anything to you?
That is Monsieur Merlin's property.
That's right. Merlin the murderer. I want to see what he's left in your safe.
Impossible. I cannot betray his confidence, no matter what you say he's done.
You're making a big mistake.
Maybe. I can live with that.
Does this matchbook mean anything to you?
No, monsieur.
Thanks for your help, buddy. Thank you. woman was obviously English. She had all the... It wasn't.
Hi, ma'am.
Hello, George. What can I do for you now?
I found this pass in Merlin's room.
So, that deceitful little man is passing himself off as an electrician, is he?
Uh-huh. This guy probably has a million faces. I showed the pass to the clerk, hoping he'd give me Merlin's papers, but he wouldn't buy it. He's too scared.
I'll give him something to be scared of. Follow me, George! Did you place a package from Merlin in the hotel safe?
I did, madame.
And did my friend here show you Merlin's identification?
Indeed he did, but...
What's the problem?
He isn't Merlin.
A mere academic detail. Give him the package.
But that is against the law.
I happen to be a justice of the peace, you silly man. I am the law. If he tries anything, shoot him, George.
My pleasure, Lady Pyrmont.
One moment, please.
You know, I haven't enjoyed myself this much since Greenham Common.
I don't know what I would have done without you, Lady Pyrmont.
Voilà, monsieur. Le manuscrit de Monsieur Merlin.
Thanks.
How satisfying. An Anglo-American alliance that actually worked.
The clerk had given me a tightly rolled sheet of parchment. I decided not to unroll it until I was safely back in Nico's apartment. It was the ancient manuscript which Cahill had stolen from Plantau.
Just a minute, monsieur.
What's your problem?
No problem, if you cooperate.
What do you want?
Just a routine security check. Nothing to worry yourself about.
Oh, well, all right.
Search him, Flap.
You bet!
Hey, knock it off. Get off, you big ape!
Is this what you're after, Guido?
See, that's it.
I can explain everything. Well, almost everything.
Too late. You're on your way to feed the fishes.
I'm allergic to fish. I break out in blotches when I eat tuna.
Let's go.
If I wanted my shins sticking out of my shoulders, I could have jumped.
Thomas Stobbart didn't raise no suicidal fools, though. I knew this was no way to treat an ancient manuscript, but I couldn't let it fall into the hands of the goons waiting outside. It was the rolled-up manuscript waiting to be retrieved. I figured it was best for me to return to the street before attempting to pick up the manuscript. The door led back into the hall, idiot.
Hi, ma'am.
Hello, George. What can I do for you now?
Do you want this key?
No, thank you, darling.
I have to go, ma'am.
Just a minute, monsieur.
What's your problem?
No problem, if you cooperate.
What do you want?
Just a routine security check. Nothing to worry yourself about.
Oh, well, all right.
Search him, Flap.
You bet!
Hey, knock it off. Get off, you big ape!
Nothing, Guido. Zilch!
Our apologies, monsieur.
What? I ought to report you to the authorities.
Round here, we are the authorities.
You want I should break his arms?
No. Let him go, Flap.
I've just been manhandled by a gorilla.
Yes? I do not see any signs of a gorilla.
No, not a real gorilla. It was a guy who looked like a gorilla. It happened right out front of this building.
Let me get this quite clear. Are you complaining or bragging?
I want to know what you're going to do about it. The scrawny one has a gun.
I suggest you contact the police.
Can't you do anything about them?
What goes on in the streets of Paris is hardly my responsibility.
Aren't you concerned that your guests are being intimidated by gangsters?
No one else has complained, monsieur. Did they steal anything from you?
Well, no. They didn't find what they were looking for.
What was that?
I don't know. I don't think they did either. Thanks for your help, buddy. Hi, ma'am.
Hello, George. What can I do for you now?
That gangster I told you about? He went through my pockets just now.
Good heavens! One never knows what to expect in foreign parts. Thank you for the warning, young man. I shall hide my credit cards in my underwear.
I have to go, ma'am. Thank you.
right there. Search him again, Flat.
Nothing, Guido.
Okay, let him go.
Hey, Shorty. I didn't think much of your trick, little man. I don't know what you're looking for, but you picked on the wrong guy. Maybe you'll spread the word around the sewers. George Stobbart is on the case. That's Stobbart. Two B's and two T's.
It sounded impressive to me, but the weasel didn't seem to share my enthusiasm. Still, I figured he'd think twice before gunning me down in the street in cold blood.
I do not like your tone.
Oh, yeah? And what are you going to do about it?
If you do not go away, I will gun you down in cold blood, right here in the street, without thinking twice about it.
Forget it. Excuse me.
Yeah?
Don't you think you have some explaining to do?
Huh?
I'm an American citizen and a bona fide visitor to your country.
What the...
You can't touch me up in the street and expect to get away with it.
Get lost, creep.
If the manuscript was what Flap and Guido were after, they were going to be disappointed. I couldn't wait to get back to Nico's apartment and check it out.
You're just not going to believe what I've found.
It's not another part of the clown's costume, is it?
It's a medieval manuscript. Khan left it in the safe at the Ubu.
It's incredible. Is this what he took from Plantar?
It could be, which means it's worth enough to kill for.
Look there, two guys on the same horse.
Oh, yeah. Maybe they couldn't afford one each. What of it?
Have you ever heard of the Knights Templar? Their official seal with an image of two knights sharing a horse. Whatever this manuscript means, it's connected with the Templars.
How come you know about these knights?
I learned about them while writing an article on the Crusades. This guy, named Hugh de Payen, arrived one day at the court of King of Jerusalem. He offered to protect the Christian pilgrims from the displaced Muslim armies. The king would be able to guarantee safe transit to Christians in the Holy Land. Safer journeys meant more pilgrims, and pilgrims meant trade and wealth. The Templars proved invaluable to the king as a mercenary army. It was said that they never asked how many the enemy numbered, just where they were. And as the years went by, the Templars grew in wealth and numbers. They were so rich. Even kings came to them for loans. But at the height of their power, they fell foul of the King of France. He rounded them up and turned them over to the Inquisition. Thousands of Templars were subject to torture and confessed to heresy. Of course, at the hands of the Inquisition, there wasn't much they wouldn't confess to. The last Grand Master Jacques de Molay was burned alive. But the treasure of the Knights Templar was never found.
Jeez. So the treasure is hidden, waiting to be discovered?
If there ever was a treasure, it's been lost for 600 years. Anyway, we're supposed to be investigating a serial killer, not a medieval treasure trove.
But maybe that's what the clown and his accomplices are after. Maybe this manuscript is the key.
You'd better leave it here for safekeeping. Think about it, George. One guy's already died for it, as you said yourself. Besides, that parchment is fragile.
Okay, I'm convinced. You keep hold of it. I found Plantau's briefcase in the killer's hotel room. It was empty, of course. I found this in the killer's room.
What is it? A credit card?
ID. Thomas Merlin, of the Gruber Electronics Corporation.
Never heard of him, or the company.
I found this matchbook in the killer's hotel room. It's from the Club Alamut.
Never heard of it. Is there anything written inside it?
No. What were you expecting?
If this was a movie, there'd be a clue. A name or an address? That's no use. There aren't even any matches in it.
Oh, well. I'll keep it as a souvenir. Hey, Nico, shake hands with me.
No chance, Buster.
Let's take another look at the manuscript.
Let's face it, we need help, George. Someone who knows about these things.
Who do you suggest? Indiana Jones?
I know a guy who specializes in medieval studies. His name is Lobino.
Huh. Some stuffy old fossil who gets horny over ancient relics, I suppose.
Far from it. André isn't the stereotypical professor you have in mind.
Where can I find this Lobino guy?
At the Kron Museum. I'll give you the address.
There's a woman looking at her reflection in a mirror, but the reflection has three hideous faces.
She reminds me of the Wicked Queen in Snow White.
She was the one who said, "Mirror, mirror on the wall," wasn't she? She made me cry so much when I was a kid. Mom carried me out of the movie theater.
She didn't frighten me in the least.
Like I said, I was only a kid. I didn't like the crocodile in Peter Pan either. A knight with a crystal ball. Now, there's something written on the scroll beside the knight.
Yes, but it's written in Latin. Per disciplinam mea lux videbis.
By my teachings, you will see the light.
You speak Latin? Where did you learn a trick like that?
A trick? I studied law, okay? I can read Latin.
My, you're touchy. Tell me that again.
Through my teachings, you will be enlightened. There's a guy working on a loom. He's weaving a carpet or a tapestry.
Or a duvet cover. It's a clue to a place, I reckon. Somewhere famed for weaving and ships.
Where folk live in barrels?
It beats copper boxes.
There's a guy with a sword and a bull.
The only mythological bull I know of is the Minotaur, but he was only half bull.
I don't think I'd like to be half a bull, even if it was the bottom half.
What's that object between them?
It looks like a gem on top of a tripod. There's a woman looking at her reflection in a mirror, but the reflection has three hideous faces. Maybe I'll check out the Kroon Museum.
I'm sure you'll find it useful, George.
Oh, hi.
Hello, my handsome friend.
Can you tell me anything about this security pass?
I can tell it doesn't belong to you.
How come?
Give me some credit. If you're an electrician, I'll eat my antirhinums.
You're a remarkably talented lady. Does this matchbook mean anything to you?
No. But I can tell you one thing. There's no such place as the Club Alamu in Paris.
Would you like to shake my hand?
No, I wouldn't. I can see the future, remember?
See you later.
That's right, monsieur. You will.
It was a public telephone. It was Rosso's sidekick, Sergeant Moo. Excuse me.
Ah, Monsieur Stobbart, n'est-ce pas?
That's correct. You remember me.
The retention of such data is part of my duty as a gendarme. That is how crime is fought, through attention to detail, not intuition.
Yes, sure. I'd like to report an assault.
Yes, monsieur? Where is the victim?
I'm the victim. I've been harassed by a pair of thugs.
I see. And where did this alleged assault take place?
Outside the Hotel Ubu. They stopped me as I was leaving and went through my pockets.
Could you describe the suspects, monsieur?
One looked like a gorilla, and the other looked like a weasel. Their names are Flap and Guido.
Bon. I'll get them this time.
What are you going to do about Flap and Guido, Sergeant?
I'm going to bust them, monsieur. For years I have been hoping to pin something on that pair. Now's my chance. I'll show them, and the inspector.
Thanks, Sergeant. Thanks for taking me seriously.
I'm only doing my duty, monsieur.
Do you know a man named Khan? He's a shifty-looking guy with a scar on his left cheek.
No, monsieur. Has this man any connection with the bombing of the cafe?
Yes. I believe Khan was the name he used when he hired the clown costume. Is Rosso here?
Yes, he is. You wish to speak to him?
Yes, I do.
One moment, monsieur. Stobbart is here to see you, monsieur.
Did he say what it was about?
No, monsieur.
Very well.
Hi, Inspector. Remember me?
But of course, Mr. Stobbart. My mind is a well-ordered faculty. A mental classification system that's the envy of the Bibliothèque Nationale. No tricks, mark you, monsieur. Just exercise. Just as our muscles waste through inactivity, so our minds decay. But there is no need. If only people would learn to exercise their wits daily.
If he was trying to impress me, it worked. He was pompous and patronizing, but he had style.
Eh bien, if you called about the bombing, you're too late. Investigations have been closed.
But
I've been taken off the case.
What about the murderer, the dead guy?
It is out of my hands.
Don't you want to know what I found out about the killer?
I told you, monsieur, the case is closed. I have washed my hands of the whole affair.
Then I'll have to continue my investigations without your help.
No. You must forget the business of the clown completely. Go back to being an ordinary tourist, Stobbart.
Do you know a pair of thugs called Flap and Guido?
I have known those two since they graduated from special school. Flap is a nasty piece of work. But Guido is the real brains of the partnership. Where did you hear of them?
I met them out front of the Hotel Ubu. Did you find out the ID of the guy who was killed in the explosion?
I already knew who he was.
I heard that the bomb victim's name was Plantar.
Your sources are reliable.
He was a big shot at the Treasury, wasn't he? Maybe that's why you've been taken off the case.
I'm sorry, monsieur. I cannot comment.
What was that psycho-detective business you did in the cafe?
It is my theory that the passions evoked in violent crimes create ripples in the ether. Invisible to all but the possessor of a highly developed and receptive mind.
I'm impressed. Can you bend spoons, too?
I didn't think a man of your obvious intelligence would stoop to mockery.
I'm not mocking.
I've had personal experience of the power of the mind. I used to get ignored at parties until I read a book that changed my life.
Really? What was it called?
Hypnotism for Fun and Profit. He looked at me as if I'd farted at a funeral.
The power of mesmerism is a rare gift, not a party trick.
You're not going to try any of that psychic interrogation on me, are you?
Do you find the thought of my probing distasteful?
Let's just say I'd rather you didn't. I've got more doubts than doubting Thomas when it comes to mysticism.
Too bad. I think you would make an interesting subject under controlled regression.
The day I let anyone mess with my mind hasn't dawned yet. Does this red nose mean anything to you?
I'd imagine it means you have not given up your pursuit of the clown.
You're absolutely right. Do you recognize the man in this photograph?
No.
It's the face of a killer.
The man who bombed the cafe?
The photograph was taken soon after the explosion. He'd escaped through the sewers, leaving a trail of clues behind him.
Circumstantial evidence, Stobbart. None of it proves a thing.
Does the name Thomas Merlin mean anything to you?
No, monsieur, nothing.
It's another one of the assumed names used by the killer.
Ah, the famous killer clown case.
Yeah. You might have forgotten all about it, but I still aim to find that guy. What do you make of this, Rosso?
It is a tool for gaining access to sewers.
Does this matchbook mean anything to you?
No, monsieur. I suggest you ask Sergeant Moo about that. God only knows why, but he collects matchbooks. He claims it is a hobby.
I found this tissue in the sewer.
It would have been best if you'd left it there.
Would you care to shake my hand, Inspector?
Please don't be offended if I decline your offer, Stobbart. The palms of my hands are particularly sensitive.
So long, Inspector. Excuse me.
What do you want now?
Does this matchbook mean anything to you, Sergeant?
That's a double-line Swedish with a crosshatch Bergman strike strip. Now, that's unusual. Pre-war Anderson hinging.
Really?
I haven't seen a reinforced Anderson outside of a private collection.
It's rare, then?
In this part of the world, yes. There are only three places these are made. Taiwan, Manila, and Slough.
Triumphantly into the building. Then I thought, no, that's dumb. Besides, I might get hurt. The attendant had an air of self-importance and the kind of steely eyes that never seemed to blink. The case contained a collection of rocks. They were all shapes and colors, but they were still rocks. Above them, a sign read, L'âge paléolithique. I tried to sneak my hand inside while the guard wasn't looking, but the case was locked. It was a statue from ancient Egypt. Those old civilizations sure could teach us a few things about art and beauty. The statue didn't deserve to be mauled by a Philistine like me. A metal rod attached to the wall was connected to the window.
Attention! Please do not open the window, monsieur.
Don't you think it's kind of stuffy in here?
Better stuffy than dead.
What's the problem? Fumes from car exhausts?
Not just that, monsieur. There's a new burger bar opened up across the street. The Laughing Buffalo.
So what's the problem?
They cook their burgers on a charcoal grill, and the fat falls on the open flames. The amount of organic compound and smoke particles released is astounding. Since they opened, local air pollution has doubled, and it stinks like a funeral pyre. That is why I keep the windows closed.
I tried to raise the glass cover of the case, but it didn't budge. The case contained two rows of silver coins. Each coin on the lower row showed a portrait of a guy with a huge nose. It was a large brass urn. There was nothing in the urn. It was a tapestry of a lady, a lion, and a unicorn. If I'd had more time, I could have stared at it all day. Touching an object as rare and beautiful as that would have been the act of a barbarian. The totem pole looked distinctly out of place in the setting of the museum. It was an ancient Egyptian sarcophagus with a beautifully painted effigy of its owner on the lid.
Leave it alone. That closet is over 3,000 years old.
Closet? It's a sarcophagus. It was a stone carving from ancient Egypt. I was no desecrator of tombs. In the case was a spindly tripod, blackened with age and pitted with rust. It was identical to the tripod pictured on the manuscript. A notice identified it as 15th century from Western Ireland. It had been found in Loch Marn at the site of a Knights Templar preceptory. Ireland!
What's that?
This tripod was found in Ireland.
I will have to ask you to keep your voice down.
I'm sorry, I was excited. The rod turned smoothly, and the window above me opened. High above me was a window. The window was wide open. This is ridiculous. I could be here for hours. The attendant had an air of... Pardon me?
Oui, monsieur?
Are you Labino?
Oh, no. Fancy you mistaking me for him. No. I am the deputy custodian.
But Labano does work here.
Work? I wouldn't go so far as to call it that. He studies here most days, but as you can see for yourself, not today.
Can you give me any further information about the tripod?
Certainly, monsieur. It's infamous. That tripod, that belonged to John Dee.
What's the importance of John Dee's tripod?
Dee was the most famous escapologist of the 16th century. The Houdini of his time.
Don't you mean alchemist? Escapologists use ropes, chains, and handcuffs, not tripods.
Well, whatever he was, that is the tripod he used in his experiments.
What kind of experiments did John Dee perform with his tripod?
Oh, the usual. Didn't you study chemistry at school?
Yeah, but we skipped over thaumatology. Can I take a closer look at the tripod?
What? Get it out of the case? No! That tripod is protected by a sophisticated surveillance system.
How sophisticated?
A painfully loud alarm bell.
How is the alarm bell triggered?
By the slightest pressure on or movement of any part of the case wherein that tripod is situated.
It strikes me that to call your alarm system sophisticated is, well, stretching the truth a little.
It has never failed yet. The sophistication is in its simplicity.
Do you know anything about the Knights of the Temple?
No, sir. Not a sausage.
The sign on the tripod says it was found at a Templar preceptory.
It does?
Yeah. It doesn't mention John Dee at all.
Most remiss.
You don't know anything about the tripod, do you?
No, I don't. I never had much of a start in life, you see. I owe a little education I gained to my uncle. He was an optician, but he also doubled as the village school teacher. He taught me the alphabet. Well, 19 letters of it. The bottom row of the chart was too small even for him to read, so he left them out.
Why don't you start over and enroll for adult education?
You know, I never thought of that. Do you think if I studied art and did all my homework, I could be a professor of history?
At your age? Dream on. Do you know anything about medieval manuscripts?
Not me, monsieur. I am no scholar, though people often mistake me for one. It is the uniform, I guess. They see the clothes. They are impressed.
And they ask you to park their cars?
They ask me to park the... No, no, no! They assume I am an authority on the exhibits in my care.
Whereas you know next to nothing about history.
Of course not. All I am saying is, I am no scholar. Not like Monsieur Labino.
What can you tell me about the collection of coins?
A rare example of silver coinage from the reign of Philippe le Bel. That little old lay buried for centuries in a field on the outskirts of Paris. They're unique. Nothing like them has been found anywhere else in Europe.
Who was Philippe le Bel?
You don't know? Philippe IV, the King of France.
Wasn't he the guy who wiped out the Knights Templar?
I have no idea, monsieur. All I know is he was King of France. I don't even know why he was called Philippe le Bel.
Do you recognize this red nose?
I don't think so.
Do you recognize the man in this photograph?
No, monsieur. Is there any reason why I should?
I guess not. Do you recognize this ID pass?
No.
What does this tool mean to you?
That belongs in a museum.
Pardon?
It is a priceless historical artifact, if I am not mistaken.
No, it's a plain old tool for lifting drain covers. Have you ever heard of the Club Alamut?
Oh no, I don't frequent places like that.
Would you like to shake my hand?
Not while I'm on duty, monsieur.
What do you make of this tissue?
It is absolutely disgusting, monsieur.
Thanks for your help.
The tripod was definitely the one in the manuscript. The temporal connection confirmed it. I was tempted to go to Ireland to check it out.
Found the tripod.
Where?
In the museum. It belonged to the Templars. It was dug up in Ireland at a place called Lochmarn.
I have heard of Lochmarn. I read an article about the castle. Take a look for yourself.
A popular gossip magazine? You read that rubbish?
No, I write it.
Professor Nigel Pegram, excavating the medieval castle at Lochmarn. That's strange.
What?
He resigned his chair at Durham University in order to devote his time to the excavation. Not only that, but he canceled the filming of a fourth series of his popular television program. This site at Lochmarn must be awful important to him.
He's a professor of history. They're all cuckoo.
All the same, I'd like to talk to this Professor Pegram. How do you feel about a trip to Ireland?
Disappointed.
Huh?
That I won't be going. I want to follow up the Bellota case. If you really think Pegram's gem is important, why don't you visit Lochmarn?
On my own? I'm not so sure about that. Where is Ireland exactly? What do you know about Professor Pegram?
I've seen a television program, Pegram's Past. He's written a book, The Crusader Families of Ireland.
I'll bet he'd be interested in the manuscript. I'll see you later.
Okay. Keep me informed if you find anything new.
Thank you.